Penguin Random House Audio presents Old Time Radio's Greatest Shows, Volume 47, featuring Lionel Barrymore, Agnes Moorehead, Orson Welles, and many more. Edited by Carl Amari.
Get this and get it straight. Crime is a sucker's road, and those who travel it wind up in the gutter, the prison, or the grave. It started with death on my doorstep and got worse when I lied to a sympathetic bull, was pistol-whipped by a gorilla with dimples, and fought with a kitten on the keys. And it might have gone on that way all night if I hadn't been helped by the king of the beasts.
From the pen of Raymond Chandler, outstanding author of mystery, comes his most famous character and crime's most deadly enemy as we present The Adventures of Philip Marlowe. Now, with Gerald Moore, starred as Philip Marlowe, we bring you tonight's exciting story, The August Lion.
It was one of those in-between hours, along about 10 on a night at home when you don't quite know what to do with yourself. Then all of a sudden it's 11, and then 11:30. And you're in slippers and a robe and have done nothing. Which is exactly where I was. Except that I'd already decided on one, and only one, very dry martini, a quiet cigarette, and bed. When it came loud, insistent, and unwelcome. No improvement when I opened up. Saw less than 5 feet of excited cab driver jumping up and down.
Mister, you Doc Marlowe?
Yeah, I'm Doc Marlowe.
That's right. Here he comes with a doc. You better make room. Is the sofa there okay? I'll clear it off.
Oh, wait a minute, Jack. Who comes? Who?
Okay, mister. Bring her on in. The doc's here, all right. Hey, Doc, is she stiff? She's out like a light.
Who?
The babe. Who do you think? Sure too bad some people can't drink, huh, Doc?
Yeah, it's real tough. Now tell me, do you...
Hello, Phil.
Judson Angel.
I'm sorry to bust in on you this way. Is the sofa all right?
No, it's stuffed with granite. Put her in the bedroom.
Okay, will you take care of the driver, please?
Yeah, yeah. How much, friend?
Well, only 80 cents on a meter, Doc.
A couple of bucks ought to cover it here. Good night.
Good night, Diamond Jim.
Well, Phil, I guess I'd better explain all this.
Uh-huh.
Here, I haven't seen you in 6 months, and when I do...
Never mind the details, Judd boy. Let's talk about the problem. Who's the girl?
Her name's Voss. Eileen Voss, she's kind of a stockbroker. Maybe speculator's a better term. You know, takes big chances with other people's money. I was in love with her, Phil, until tonight.
When what happened?
When I found out I was just one of many, it threw me, Phil. I really lost my temper. I swore I'd kill her on sight.
Yeah, most guys do at a time like that, Judd. What's that got to do with her being drunk? And by the way, while we're talking, I'll put on some coffee,
no.
Huh?
No, don't, Phil.
Why not?
Because it can't help. She had a shot too many, all right. Only this one's a bullet in her head. She's dead.
Oh, fine.
Now, Phil, listen, please. You've got to help me. I've got to find out who did it. Phil, it started a couple of hours ago when I found out she'd been playing me for a sucker. I went to her place the first time in a week, boiling mad. The door was open.
Judson's angel's eyes never left my face as he told the story from the beginning. A girl's body on the couch when he walked in, a neat hole in the back of her head. The gun he knew she owned shoved under a pillow. Then in the next second, before he could even look in the other rooms, the arrival of the cabbie somebody'd called who thought Eileen was just another drunk who had to be shown the way to go home. How he seized on that as an opportunity to keep from being placed at the scene of the murder he had every reason to commit. How minutes after he was in the cab, he realized he was near my place. How to avoid suspicion, he said I was a doctor. Everything except why, specifically, he was so afraid of the police. I knew that was going to be next.
Now, Phil, I suppose you want to know why I couldn't possibly call the police.
Yeah, that's right. Why?
Because I'd surely be booked and fingerprinted. And that'd ruin me. You see, a long time ago, I served time in the state penitentiary in Illinois.
What?
Yes, yes, so I've kept it quiet. Only Phoebe Hammond in my office knows. It was for forgery, Phil. It was under another name, and way back when I didn't know the difference between clever business and crooked business.
Mm.
It's taken 10 years to work up my reputation as an accountant. So you see, if I get mixed up in this, it'll all come out and... Well, smash, lots of pieces, no more. Oh, you've got to help me, Phil. You've got to find the real killer before the police get to me. Please, Phil.
I can't, Judd. It'd be smashing just as many little pieces for me, too, if I tried to pull anything like this on homicide. No, I'm sorry, Judd. I've got to report this body.
But, Phil, look, what if you do report the body, but you say that you don't know anything about it, that you're going out to find what you can? What about that, Phil? Oh, please. Please, Phil.
Okay. What's the girl's address?
91 Hollycrest Drive.
91 Hollycrest.
Yeah, the door wasn't locked, Phil.
Mm-hmm. Your phone number, Judd?
Gladstone 3926. I won't move out of my place until I hear from you.
Now, make sure you don't, Judd. Because if I can't find the real killer, I've got to tell what I know about you. You understand that, don't you? When Angel left, I called Detective Lieutenant Matthews at police headquarters and lied that there was a corpse in my apartment about which I knew nothing, and that I was on my way out to see what I could find. Then I hung up fast, not feeling very good. 20 minutes later, when I was in the plush living room at 91 Hollycrest Drive, I had zero to go on. Until I got to the bedroom where, caught in the folds of lace at the bottom of a petticoated vanity, I found a piece of male jewelry that stood out against that backdrop like Argyle socks on a turtle. It was a gold tie clasp ornamented with the figure of a lion, a little more majestic than most. I dropped it into my pocket and then moved out into a long hall that led to the kitchen. I was about to start toward it when he spoke.
Don't move, buddy.
Like the voice, he was thick and soft, especially in the middle where he was girdled in double-breasted gray flannel. So I couldn't tell whether he was plus or minus a tie clasp. Also, he had no hair and a pair of deep dimples that danced when he talked. A gun in his hand didn't.
Okay, turn around. Let's go back to the living room, buddy. I want to ask you a few questions. Like why you're taking inventory here.
Well, it's my job. You see, I'm an auctioneer. The lady of the house won't need this stuff anymore. She's not
going to... Shut up. Now stop where you are, and don't turn around. Okay, where's the girl? Come on, where is she?
Out. And only if you'll tell me why you want to know, will I tell you where. You see, that way I come out even.
Yeah, maybe. Well, Eileen Voss owes me money, buddy, and I want it now before she's flat broke. Now you, where is she?
On her way to the morgue, like you don't know.
Oh, what do you mean by that? I didn't kill her?
Honest Injun.
Listen, you, get this straight. I came into this place just now for one reason only. To check on the Voss girl and make sure she wasn't on her way out of town, bag and baggage in hand, and my 50 grand. Now, don't forget that.
I'll try not to.
And don't move. Hello. No, she's not here. She, Judy? Yeah, it's me, honey. No, she's out. Yeah. Well, I'll tell you about it later at the club. Yeah. Right, Judy. So long. Now, where were we, buddy?
In the middle of a big fat lie, your reason for being here.
Oh, yeah. That's where we were. And you know, that's a good old place to leave it. Ah! Oh, buddy.
When the twin telephones, lamps, and end tables next to me got back to being one of each again, I saw the note next to the phone that said, "Call Monday at the garden room." Which didn't add to much until I realized that Monday was spelled not as the day in the week, but M-U-N-D-Y. And I recalled that the garden room was a cozy collection of crepe paper flowers where some people did their serious drinking. That plus dancing dimples telling a girl named Judy, who had called for Eileen in the first place, that he'd meet her at the club was a little better than the zero-plus tie clasp I'd been working with. And a half hour later, that little became a lot, and things started to dovetail because a placard under glass in front of the garden room bragged about the glamour puss pianist featured inside, whose name was first Judy, second Monday, not his day in the week. I blessed my good luck, exchanged smiles only with a head-check girl in the lobby, and found a table for one inside, not more than a half a dozen octaves away from Miss Monday's left hand. I'd ordered a drink and had a cigarette going before she paid any attention to me.
I'll play anything you want. It's a rule of the house. Just name it, or hum it, or whistle. But don't croon. That's also a rule of the house. What'll it be?
How about the number you always play for that fat friend of yours? You know, the one with the deep dimples?
Burleffy?
Hmm.
Sure. It's kind of corny. Remember it?
Yeah.
You a friend of his?
Not exactly.
I didn't think so. He'd crown you if he heard you say dimples. He's sensitive. You're new here, aren't you?
I've been in once or twice. mutual friend of ours used to speak well of you. Eileen Voss.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.